Welcome to the second video of this first part of the course in quantum mechanics. In this video, we will look at the wave property of a particle and its experimental proof, the de Broglie wave and its representation as a wave packet, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, the concept of wave function, and the probabilistic interpretation of the wave function. I will devote this slide to a discussion on the scattering of X-rays from crystals. Following Röntgen's discovery of X-rays in 1895, intense efforts were made to determine the nature and origin of these new penetrating radiation. By 1912, it was clear that X-rays are produced primarily in nuclear transitions, and they were a form of highly energetic electromagnetic radiation, having extremely small wavelengths of the order of 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. Knowing that the distance between atoms in a crystal is also about 10 to the power of minus 10 meter, Max von Laue, a young theoretical physicist at the University of Munich, made the brilliant suggestion that X-rays should scatter from the atoms of crystals, and if X-rays were a form of electromagnetic radiation, then interference effects should be observed. From the study of optics, we know that wave properties are more easily demonstrated when the sizes of apertures and obstructions are of the same order as the wavelength of light. Von Laue suggested that crystals may act as a three-dimensional grating and scattering of X-rays and produce observable interference effect. Max von Laue, who received incidentally the Nobel Prize in 1914, designed the experiment and convinced two of his experimental physicist colleagues at Munich, Walter Friedrich and Paul Kipping, to perform the measurement. The picture in this slide shows the Von Laue photograph of the scattered X-rays from a crystal. Independently, two English physicists, William Henry Bragg and his son William Lawrence Bragg, fully exploited the wave nature of X-rays and simplified Von Laue's analysis. W.L. Bragg pointed out in 1912 that each of the images surrounding the bright central spot of the Laue photograph should be interpreted as the reflection of incident X-ray beam from a unique set of planes of atoms within the crystal. In fact, each dot in the pattern should correspond to a different set of planes in the crystal. It turns out from an analysis of the scattering that there are two conditions for constructive interference of scattered X-rays from two successive layers of atoms in a crystal. In fact, these conditions are: number one, the angle of incidence must be equal to the angle of reflection of the outgoing wave, and two, the difference in path lengths between the two waves that interfere must be an integral multiple of the wavelength lambda. This condition is mathematically written as 2d sine theta equal to n lambda, where d and theta have the meaning shown in the figure. This is known as the Bragg law. The Bragg's law gave a very powerful tool to physicists, in some manner of speaking, to use X-rays to determine crystal structures. The figure also shows the pattern of X-ray diffraction from different crystals when an X-ray beam is incident on it. In the first video course, we saw the compelling evidence for the particle nature of radiation and consequently the dual nature of radiation. Now the obvious question is whether there is a wave nature associated with particles. Physicists have immense faith in the symmetry exhibited in nature. In fact, we can find several arguments based on symmetry principle throughout physics. Progress in physics can often be characterized by long periods of experimental and theoretical drudgery, punctuated occasionally by flashes of insight that cause profound changes in the way we view the universe. Frequently, the more profound the insight and bolder the initial step, the simplest it seems in historical perspective, and more likely we are to ask, why didn't I think of that? Einstein's special theory of relativity is one such example of such insight. The hypothesis of the Frenchman Louis de Broglie is another. Louis de Broglie, invoked the symmetry argument to propose that if radiation has dual nature, then particle 2 should have the same property, namely dual nature. In other words, he proposed that the particle will have a wave property or wave nature associated with it. Let's be sure that his argument was not backed by any experimental evidence at that time. His logic went along these lines. A photon, the particle manifestation of radiation, has a momentum P equal to E by C, where E is its energy, which according to Einstein is h nu, and C is the speed of light or electromagnetic radiation. Thus, the momentum of the photon is P equal to h nu by C or h by lambda, since frequency nu divided by C, the speed, is nothing but 1 over lambda, lambda being the wavelength of radiation. Thus, we may write the momentum of a photon as h by lambda. Now, Debroglie argued that the equation P equal to h by lambda is general. It applies to particles as well. So, we may rewrite the equation as lambda equal to h by P, where lambda is the wavelength of the wave associated with a moving particle which possesses a momentum P. The following two points are to be immediately noted. Since lambda is related to momentum P, only moving particles will exhibit the wave-like property. Stationary particles may not be exhibiting the wave aspect at all. Further, owing to the smallness of the Planck's constant, the wavelength lambda will be extremely small. In this slide, we have calculated the wavelength for a ping pong ball, a cricket ball, a football, and an alpha particle. The values chosen are realistic values of their masses and their speeds. What do we see from the slide? We note from the slide that the wavelength that is computed is extremely small in the case of the ping pong ball, cricket ball, or football, while it is of the same order of magnitude for an alpha particle. Now, because of the smallness of H, only for particles of atomic or nuclear scale will the wave behavior be observable. Two questions immediately follow. First, just what kind of wave are we talking about in this Debroglie wavelength? That is, what does the amplitude of the Debroglie wave measure? This is not an easy question to answer, so I will defer it for a detailed discussion until the last section of this video. For the present, let's assume that associated with the particle as it moves, there is a Debroglie wave of wavelength lambda, which shows itself when a wave type experiment, such as say diffraction, is performed on it. The outcome of the wave experiment, of course, depends on the wavelength that we have associated with it. Now, if you carefully observe the wave property, it turns out that we could ask the following questions. Number one, is there any experimental evidence for this so-called wave nature of the particle? And how do we represent the wave associated with the particle? And finally, to go back to my earlier question, what exactly does this matter wave, as it came to be known, really represent? We will address these questions one by one. Incidentally, there are several other ways in which one can write the wavelength of a moving particle. For instance, since the momentum is related to the kinetic energy, for a charged particle which is accelerated through a potential difference V, the kinetic energy would be QV, and hence one could write its Debroglie wavelength, that is of a charged particle, as lambda equal to h by square root of 2 times m into Q into V, where m is the mass of the charged particle, Q is its charge, and V is the electric potential difference through which it is accelerated. Okay, let's try to answer the questions that was raised in the previous slide. Let's begin with the first question. Is there an experimental evidence for the wave nature of a particle? One of the phenomena that characterizes a wave is the phenomena of diffraction, as was already mentioned. We also saw in some detail the scattering of X-rays from periodic crystal lattice governed by the well-known Bragg condition 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. Let's recollect that d is the interplanar spacing, theta the scattering angle, and lambda the wavelength of X-ray. In the year 1925, Davison and Germer, working at the Bell Telephone Laboratories, were studying the properties of metallic surfaces by scattering electrons from various materials. In fact, the experimental arrangement used by Davison and Germer, we note that the intensity of the scattered X-ray beam could be studied as a function of the electron energy for a given scattering angle. Alternately, one could also study the intensity of the scattered beam at different scattering angles for a given electron energy. Well, how does one vary the electron energy? Simply by accelerating the electron beam through different electric potentials. It turns out that when you study the intensity of the scattered electron beam, Davison and Germer noticed that for one particular set of experiment, the scattered electron beam showed a maximum intensity when the scattering angle was around 50 degrees, and the accelerating potential was 54 volt. Now, what does this mean? According to Davison and Germer, the peak intensity, which is seen at 50 degree, represents the scattering of the matter wave associated with electron at a scattering angle of 50 degree, which can be understood from the geometry of the situation. Now, if you go back to the Debroglie wavelength formula that relates the kinetic energy of a charged particle to the Debroglie wavelength lambda, we know that lambda equal to h divided by root of 2 mev. Now, when we substitute the values of mass of the electron, charge of the electron, and the accelerating voltage, which is 54 volt, the wavelength associated with the matter wave of electron is 0.165 nanometer. Now, here comes the clinching argument. If you apply the Bragg's condition, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda, knowing that the interatomic spacing in the crystal of nickel is around 0.215 nanometer and the scattering angle, as we saw, is 50 degree, the wavelength lambda works out to be, you guessed it, 0.165 nanometer. Now, this was the direct evidence of scattering of the matter wave from periodic crystal lattice, which is identical with the scattering of X-rays from periodic crystal lattice. So therefore, one has direct experimental evidence for the wave nature of a particle. In the next slide, we will compare a couple of photographs of electron diffraction and X-ray. Around the same time that Davison and Germer performed their experiment with electron beam scattered from nickel crystal to prove the wave character of electron, Sir G.P. Thomson independently performed an experiment on electron diffraction from gold foil in England. Thomson's experiment clearly showed that electrons are diffracted from gold foils and produce patterns which are identical to the ones obtained by Sir William Bragg and Sir Lawrence Bragg in their experiment with X-rays from crystal lattice structures. In this slide, we have compared the diffraction photographs of X-ray diffraction and electron diffraction, both by the law method as well as the rotating crystal method. I would urge you to look at the extraordinary similarity between the two patterns, which is direct evidence for the wave nature of electrons. I would like to devote a couple of minutes to the remarkable father-son duo of Sir J.J. Thomson and George Paget Thomson. While Sir J.J. Thomson discovered the electron and established it as a fundamental particle and one of the ultimate constituents of matter, his son George Paget Thomson proved that electron had wave nature. The father was awarded a Nobel Prize for establishing the particle nature of electron, while the son got the prize for establishing its wave nature. Truly remarkable and inspiring story, isn't it? So it was that the physicists came to accept the fact that particles also exhibit a wave property, and thus the dual nature of radiation was extended to dual nature of particle or matter as well. This duality of radiation and matter is at the very heart of quantum physics, and as you will see, we will be referring to it quite repeatedly throughout this. Let's now try to answer the second question that we raised. How do we mathematically represent a wave associated with the particle? Suppose we consider a pure sine wave of the form y equal to y1 sine k1x. We note that this wave repeats itself endlessly from x equal to minus infinity to x equal to plus infinity. So if we ask the question, where is the wave located? We obviously cannot provide an answer, for it is everywhere. Its wavelength, on the other hand, is very precisely determined, and by the way, is equal to 2 pi by k1. If we are to use a wave to represent a particle, the wave must have one of the important attributes of a particle. That is, it must be localized, or it must be confined to a small region of space, like within an atom or a nucleus, for example. Because of its infinite extent, a pure sine wave is of no use in localizing particles. So what do we do? Suppose we now consider adding to our original wave a wave of slightly different wavelength, say k2, so that the new wave is y equal to y1 sine k1x plus y2 sine k2x. This characteristic pattern, known in the case of sound waves as beats, is produced or shown in the figure. The pattern still endlessly repeats from x equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, but we now know a bit more about the position of the wave, because at certain values of x, the medium is far less likely to be waving than at others. The state of our knowledge of the position of the wave has definitely improved, but it is at the expense of our knowledge of its wavelength. We added together, remember, two different wavelengths, and so the wavelength is no longer precisely determined. Suppose we continue to add waves of different wavelengths, that is different wave numbers k, with properly chosen amplitudes and phases, we would eventually reach a situation similar to the one illustrated in figure 2. This wave has virtually no amplitude outside a rather narrow region of space delta x. Of course, delta x is not precisely defined, but is definitely a rough measure of the region over which the wave has a reasonably large amplitude. In order to achieve this situation, we must add together a large number of waves of different wave numbers k. Let us, for example, imagine that we are adding, a number of waves whose wavelengths ranges from k0 minus delta k by 2 to, let us say, k0 plus delta k by 2. If all the waves have the same amplitude, then the resultant wave can be represented by an equation shown in the slide. That is, y of x equal to 2a divided by x times sine delta k by 2x times cos k0x. This represents the cosine function cos k0x oscillating within the envelope, which is 2a by x sine delta kx by 2. In other words, we have a large number of waves within the envelope, and the envelope itself moves with a certain speed. The speed of the individual waves within the envelope is known as their phase speed or phase velocity, while the speed of the envelope known as the group velocity or group speed. It can be shown that the group velocity, which represents a wave packet, is d omega by dk. The envelope of the wave packet moves at the group velocity, while within the envelope
each individual component moves with its phase velocity. Now, in summary, therefore, we could say a particle that is localized in a certain region of space must be represented by a wave packet rather than a single de Broglie wave of definite frequency and wavelength. The envelope of the wave packet moves at the group velocity d omega by dk, and it can be shown rather easily that this group velocity actually is the velocity of the particle. Therefore, the velocity of the particle equal to the group velocity of the corresponding wave packet means the wave packet and the particle move together. Wherever the particle goes, its de Broglie wave packet moves along with it like a shadow. If we do a wave type experiment on the particle, then the de Broglie wave packet is always there to reveal the wave nature or behavior of the particle. A particle can never escape its wave nature. So in effect, we can represent a particle's wave property by a group of waves called a wave packet. But what is the price that we are going to pay? We will see that in the We noted that when we continue to add a large number of waves of different wavelengths, that is different k, with properly chosen amplitudes and phases, we would eventually reach a situation known as a wave packet. The wave packet has virtually no amplitude outside a rather narrow region of space, delta x. Even though delta x is not precisely defined, it's a rough measure of the region over which the wave has a reasonably large amplitude. In order to achieve this situation, I once again reiterate that we must add together a large number of waves of different wave numbers k. The wave thus represents a range of wave numbers or wavelengths that we denote by delta k. When we had a single sine wave, delta k was zero because only one value of k was there, and delta x, on the other hand, was infinite because the wave extended throughout all space. As we increased delta k by adding more and more waves, we effectively decreased delta x. The wave became more confined. We seem to have an inverse relationship between delta x and delta k. As one increases, the other decreases. An approximate mathematical relationship between delta x and delta k would be delta x delta k is of the order of 1. Since we have not yet defined delta x and delta k precisely, they could be regarded as estimates, and the above equation is a rough indication of their relationship. In fact, the equation delta x delta k is of the order of 1 asserts that the product delta x, the spatial extent of the wave, and delta k, the range of wave numbers it contains, is of the order of magnitude 1. For any type of wave, the position can be determined only at the expense of our knowledge of its wavelength. This statement and its mathematical representation given above is a kind of an uncertainty relationship for classical wave. The position and wavelength are mutually uncertain to the degree given by the equation delta x delta k is of the order of 1. In fact, we can make similar arguments about the time dependence of the wave as well. One could show that delta omega delta t is also of the order of 1, where delta omega is the spread in the angular frequency of the wave and delta t is the time over which we try to measure the wavelength or frequency of the wave. This uncertainty relationship has a far-reaching consequence in quantum mechanics, as we shall see in the next.
We'll now describe what is arguably one of the most important concepts in quantum mechanics, the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. In the previous slide, we looked at certain uncertainty relationships in the context of waves. Since it applied to waves, it should apply to de Broglie waves as well. We can use the basic de Broglie relationship P equal to h by lambda and the expression k equal to 2 pi by lambda to find that P, the momentum of a particle, could be written as P equal to H into K by 2 pi, or alternately P equal to H cross K, where H cross stands for H by lambda. If P equals H cross K, then it follows that delta K must be equal to delta P by H cross. Thus, from the uncertainty relation, delta X delta K is of the order of 1, we now find delta X delta PX is of the order of H cross. We have written a subscript X to the momentum delta P. So, to remind us that the above equation delta X delta PX is of the order of H cross applies to motion in a given direction and relates the uncertainties in position and momentum in that direction only. Similar and independent relations can also be applied to other directions. For instance, delta Y delta PY is of the order of H bar, or delta Z delta PZ is of the order of H bar. We may further even write an energy time relationship as delta E delta T is of the order of H bar. The equation number 1, delta X delta PX of the order of H bar, and delta E delta T of the order of H bar represent what are called Heisenberg's uncertainty relationship. They are the mathematical representations of a fundamental principle known as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. It states, it is not possible to make a simultaneous determination of the position and momentum of a particle with unlimited precision. And it is not possible to make a simultaneous determination of the energy and the time coordinate of a particle with unlimited precision. These relationships give an estimate of the minimum uncertainty that can result from any experiment. Measurement of the position and momentum of a particle will always give a spread of values of width delta X and delta PX. We may for other reasons do much worse than what the equation suggests, but we can do no better. I would like to mention here that occasionally you may see these relationships written as H bar by 2 or H bar, or sometimes just H on the right hand side, or else with a greater than sign rather than of the order of sign. These differences are not very important, since these equations basically give us only estimates. Now, these relationships have a profound impact on our view of nature. It is quite acceptable to say that there is an uncertainty in locating the position of a water wave. It is quite another matter altogether to make the same statement about a de Broglie wave, since there is an implied corresponding uncertainty in the position of the particle. Equations 1 and 2, which was mentioned above, say that nature imposes a limit on the accuracy with which we can do experiments. No matter how well designed our measuring apparatus might be, we still can do no better than what the equations 1 and 2 suggest. To determine the momentum accurately, we must measure over a very long distance delta X. On the other hand, if we wish to confine a particle to a small region of space delta X, we lose our ability to measure its momentum accurately. Similarly, to measure an energy with a small uncertainty takes a long time delta T. If, on the other hand, a particle lives only for a short interval of time, then its energy uncertainty will be very large. I considered an example to make these ideas clear. Suppose you consider an electron which is moving along the x direction with a speed of, let's say, 3.6 into 10 power 6 meter per second. And we can measure its speed to a precision of, let's say, 1%. Now, with what precision can we simultaneously measure its position along the x-axis? Also, what can we say about its motion along the y direction? Considering the x direction, the electron's momentum, Px, will be m times Vx, which gives you a value of 3.3 into 10 to the power of minus 24 kg meter per second. The uncertainty in its momentum, delta Px, is 1% of this value, which is 3.3 into 10 to the power of minus 26 kg meter per second. The uncertainty in its position, therefore, would be delta X of the order of H cross by delta Px, which is about 3.2 nanometer. 3.2 nanometer is roughly 10 atomic diameters. That means the position of an electron is uncertain to about 10 atomic diameters. Now, if the electron is moving along the x direction, then we know its speed in the y direction exactly. That is zero. In other words, delta Py is zero. If the uncertainty delta Py is zero, then according to the uncertainty relation, delta Y delta Py is of the order of H cross, we require the uncertainty in delta Y to be infinite. We can therefore know nothing at all about the electron's Y coordinate. This is the essence of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle.
We now come to the last question that was posed in the first slide. What does the amplitude of the de Broglie wave represent? We know that in general, in any wave, the disturbance represents the change in the value of a physical quantity. So what is the physical quantity we are referring to in the case of a matter wave? The interpretation was given by Max Born. The quantity whose variation make up the matter wave is called the wave function. It is represented by the Greek letter psi. The value of the wave function psi for a moving particle at any particular point x, y, z in space at a time t is written as psi of x, y, z, t. More about the wave function and how to determine it in the next video. For now, we will look at the physical significance of this wave function, which represents the matter wave. Now, in the previous section, we discussed the representation of a localized particle as a wave packet. If a particle is confined to a region of space of dimension delta x, the wave packet that represents the particle has large amplitude only in that region of space of dimension delta x, and it has small amplitude elsewhere. In other words, the amplitude is large where the particle is likely to be found and small where the particle is less likely to be found. The probability of finding a particle at any point therefore depends on the amplitude of its de Broglie wave at that point, or depends on the amplitude of the wave function at that point. Now, this was the line of thought that was taken by Max Born in giving a physical interpretation to the meaning of matter wave. The point is, there is an analogy in classical physics. You would recall that the intensity of any wave is proportional to the square of its amplitude. In fact, the probability to observe a photon at any point in space is proportional to the square of the electric field's amplitude at that point. This analogy was used to the maximum extent, in some sense I should say, by Max Born in his interpretation of the wave function. The physical interpretation of matter wave given by Max Born is the following. The quantity whose variation make up the matter wave, known as a wave function, as already mentioned, can have a value which is either positive or negative. In fact, the value of the wave function in general turns out to be complex, as we will see. The wave function psi itself has no direct physical significance. In other words, psi cannot be interpreted in terms of any experiment. However, the probability of finding a particle at a particular place, at a particular instant, will be a positive number between 0 and 1. Now, the amplitude of the matter wave, that is the amplitude of psi, can be positive and negative, positive or negative, and clearly a negative probability has no meaning. However, mod psi squared, the square of the absolute value of the wave function at any point in space at any time, which is called the probability density, is related to the probability of finding the particle at that particular point at that instant of time. This is the interpretation of the wave function according to Max Born.
In other words, I quote, the probability of experimentally locating a particle described by the wave function psi at a point xyz at an instant t is proportional to the value of psi squared at xyt at that instant t. Unquote. In general, since psi is complex and is a function of space and time, we may use instead of mod psi squared, psi star psi. More about this in the next video. Alternately, one may even say that if an experiment involving many identical particles, all described by the same wave function psi, is made, then the actual density, that is number of particles per unit volume of the particles at xyz at time t, is proportional to the corresponding value of mod psi squared at xyz at t. Now, therefore, we have the probabilistic interpretation of the wave function. We therefore write p of x dx is equal to mod psi xt whole squared dx, which means mod psi xt whole squared dx represents the probability of finding the particle within a small interval x to x plus dx. Since the particle has to be there somewhere out there in space, the probability of locating it anywhere in space would be 1. In other words, if you integrate mod of psi xt whole squared dx between the limits minus infinity to plus infinity, or integrate psi star psi between the limits minus infinity to plus infinity, the value of the integral must be 1. This condition is known as normalization condition on the wave function. In the next video, when we discuss Schrodinger equation, we will talk about the conditions that the wave function must obey and also come back to this probabilistic interpretation of the wave function. Max Born, who proposed this idea in 1926, was given the Nobel Prize in 1954. He is considered as one of the founders of the quantum theory. The determination of the wave function psi of xt is the central problem in quantum mechanics, which we will discuss in the next video.